We are going to start a session, Legacy of the Mahatma. And speakers of the session are Rajmohan Gandhi, and then Sara Ansari. Both of them are academicians, historians, researchers. Rajmohan Gandhi's recent book has become a hot cake of this event, and it reminds me, decade ago, Dr. Sara Ansari's book, Peace and State Power, was received a similar warm welcome, and it went well, in especially in the Sen, because its content were mostly focused on Sen. The legacy of Mahatma, we are going to start with a book launch. Book is recently published by Phoenix Books. If you Google it, the website, you will find the 5,000 titles about the life and works of Mahatma Gandhi. But if you categorize it, specified it, the children literature and Mahatma Gandhi, perhaps you may find some books. Perhaps you may find 50, 100. But the most book, which is frequently, ever since its first publication in Bangla language, it is being repeated, it is being published. It has been translated in 8 languages: Marathi, Bengali, Gujarati, Hindi. And recently, last week, it has been translated in Sindhi language. I would like to request the publisher of the book, Rosina Junejo, to present the book, Rajmohan Gandhi and Dr. Sara Ansari. Rosina Junejo. Book is written by a Bengali lady, Anu Bindyapadhyay. Anu Bindyapadhyay was a Gandhian. He worked with a Bengali woman. He never accepted government services. He never accepted government rewards. He lived in the rural areas, and his last life, he was in Calcutta. Nehru government offered two times there was offer from the Nehru to join the government, but she very humbly, very politely refused to work with the Indian government. So I am very thankful to Anu Bindyapadhyay, who was commonly known as Anu Di. In Urdu translation, Anu Bhen. In Sindhi, Anu Bhen. She is a well-known figure in the India now through this book in subcontinent. So after that, my question is, since the partition, in Sindhi language, continuously books are being published. First book was published in 36. Then there was Gita Bodh. Then there was the latest Papu. And in 80s, there was Lois Fisher's famous book, Gandhi. So my question from Rajmohan Gandhi is, why Sindhi people are continuously publishing the books on Gandhi? Is it identity crisis? Is it discontent with Federation's created hero? Or it is South to South relation?
Thank you, Zaffar Junejo Sahab, for you and your publisher giving me a copy of this wonderful book. Lekin ek baat aur main, if you can allow me, mujhe ek baat kehne ki marzi ho rahi hai, which is not connected to your question or indeed to the theme of this meeting. Because just before I came to this platform, I had the great joy and privilege of meeting this wonderful lady who is sitting in that wheelchair. She is the daughter of somebody that some of you may not have heard of, but Shoaib Qureshi was one of the giants of India's national movement and a very powerful writer. And as a researcher 40, 50 years ago when I started researching on the Indian freedom movement, I was so inspired by Shoaib Qureshi's writings. And for me today to meet his daughter, and she presented me a picture of herself as a baby with Gandhiji, and I've very seldom seen M.K. Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi, being sent into such total, uproarious, uncontrollable laughter as by this lady who is in the wheelchair now. So I felt I had to take this liberty of sharing my joy and excitement at receiving this photograph of Gandhiji with this lady and having a chance to meet her in view of what I know about her amazing father, Shoaib Qureshi. Now, on your question, why are so many Sindhi books being published about Gandhi? Iska to jawab aap mujhe dein, main kaise aapko do? To ye to meri shikayat hai, aapki nahi ho sakti hai. Mujhe bahut khushi hai. All I can say is because I don't really know Sindhi society here, even though my wife is originally from Sindh.
Yes.
So I'm very lucky on that, but then she has not shared too many secrets with me about Sindhi society. So I don't know why Sindhis have been interested in Gandhi, but I can make a guess. You have asked three possibilities: search for identity, south to south, vagaira. Lekin mujhe lagta hai, there is something very simple about this. The human heart, the average human being, longs for something, what shall I say, something human, something sort of satisfying. Now, no human being can completely satisfy other human beings. Yes. It's impossible. M.K. Gandhi can't sort of satisfy every human being, or even himself, or his wife, or his grandchildren. But there is something appealing in a human sense about Gandhi, both as an individual and about the way in which he conducted his struggle. And that seems to appeal to the human being. And I think it goes beyond Sindhi-ness. I think it is something human and perhaps universal.
Yes, true. Dr. Sara, how you look at a historian? What is the material connections? What is the political connections of doing continuously publishing of Sindhi books about and on the Gandhi's works and life?
Sorry. Say that again.
I want to know that what are the historical perspective, and what are the factors which are influencing Sindhis to continuously publish books on Gandhiji?
I suppose we have to take a long-term perspective on this. So you mentioned books published nearer to, well, during his lifetime. You mentioned books published since.
Yes.
I totally understand what Gandhiji has just been saying. I think also, though, we have to look at the history of this region. We look at its, perhaps, search for an identity in a newly created state within which, you know, there were and have been problems as far as, you know, the provincial-federal relationship is concerned, centre and provinces. And I suppose what's become very important for some Sindhis, at least, I'm not going to generalise, but some Sindhis, is to be able to flag up what's important to them about their identity. And I think, you know, that syncretic tradition that existed among at least some groups of Sindhis prior to independence has become very important to a lot of Sindhis today. And maybe because of Gandhi, Mahatma Gandhi's role, because of what he symbolized, that's something that attracts them to him now, because it reinforces that that pride in their more, let's say, syncretic past than maybe what we associate with parts of Pakistan today. So I think there's that also explanation that helps us to understand the patterns, the traditions that you've just been discussing.
Oh, yes. My question from Rajmohan Gandhi. In very simple, for a very common man, what is the legacy of Mahatma? It is Satyagraha, it is non-violence, it is the truth, it is the love, it is self-realization.
Thank you for this wonderful question also. So what is the legacy of Gandhi? That is something that different individuals who are interested in him perhaps decide in their own minds. What is it about him or his life or his struggle that has a lasting or continuing impression on their minds and hearts? And I think the values you have mentioned about Satyagraha, love, truthfulness, self-realization, these are all, I think, very powerful concepts which resonate in many people's minds. I would say that, and here again, I think it's not so easy for somebody to make an assessment of much of humanity or of hundreds or thousands or millions of human beings and say why they like a particular person or respond to a particular idea. Unless one does a proper scientific survey and find out, which I've never had the chance to do, but I will give you one or two guesses of mine. I would say that Gandhi was a very novel person, and in some ways this was almost an inconsistent thing in him. He was standing for two seemingly contradictory things. We must fight against domination. No matter how weak we may be, how poor we may be, if somebody is trying to dominate over us, we must absolutely stand up and fight. So, and many human beings all over the world responded to it. You know, I've had the privilege of going to different countries. I have met Native Americans, you know, Native Americans in Canada, in the United States, even in South America. Of course, I've met so many African Americans. I've met many black Africans in Africa. People from Okinawa, the so-called Aboriginals of Australia, the Maoris of New Zealand. All of them, for whatever reason, rightly or wrongly, I find that they are very interested in me because they feel that Mahatma struggle was similar to their struggle, that he was standing up to some kind of domination, and you might say some kind of racial domination. So he becomes a symbol of the struggle of the non-white peoples of the world. Whether he deserves to be that symbol or not is not the question. The human beings all over the world seem to think that he is a symbol. Also very true in the Arab world, I found that too. But simultaneously, along with this desire to fight domination, he also says, we will fight with superior means. We will not use violence. We will be very different from the one who is dominating us. We will present the stark opposite of domination. We will use non-violence. Ashish Nandi Sahab just now at this, he was speaking about the amazing response in the frontier province and Badshah Khan's work also.
Yes.
Now, this idea that you should fight domination, but you should fight it with non-violence, gave the oppressed people of the world the possibility that they will stand on the moral high ground. So this opportunity Gandhi gives to the weak person to fight domination, fight oppression, and claim the moral high ground is one way of understanding his impact.
Dr. Sara, how you will connect legacy and history as an academician.
Okay. Can I first, before I turn to that question, just pick up on what said? I think Gandhi, like many other individuals, kind of great men of history, let's call them, can be seen in many different ways. There are many Gandhis, in other words.
Yes, sure.
Yeah. People see him differently, partly because they interact with him differently according to their own circumstances. So certainly I completely agree with what you said as far as his symbolic resonance with oppressed people. And you talked about people of colour outside the West. From a Western perspective, we shouldn't overlook how important his lessons were for people's pacifists working in the West after the Second World War, after the first atomic bombs had been dropped, when movements for nuclear disarmament picked up momentum. The green movement in the West, environmentalism, they all can, in different ways, these movements look back to Gandhi's experience and the lessons that he left us with. So I think he can appeal, his legacies resonate both in the West and the non-West. But I think something that really strikes me as far as a legacy is concerned is that, as at least the way I read him, so it's sort of from my point of view, the fact that Gandhi recognised in a lot of what he did that fresh situations often required new thinking. So he was prepared or not afraid to change his mind. So theory came out of praxis, came out of real experience. And, you know, if that created inconsistencies, well, that was just because life is like that. So a readiness to think again, to think freshly about the situation he found himself in. I think that's a lesson for everybody today, because we get very much mired in our particular way of looking at the world or way of approaching solving problems. And if we can take something from that, then perhaps we open our minds up to looking at problem solving in new ways. So I see that as an important legacy too. So just to add to what you've been saying, now you asked me a question and I've obviously forgotten it again. So how we reconcile, could you repeat what you asked me?
Legacy and history.
Legacy and history. Oh, well, history in many ways is about remembering. And remembering means, to a large extent, interpreting, reinterpreting the past. So I think that something like legacy, that word, is not static. You know, it changes over time. It's very much a product of the relationship between what's happening at a certain point in time and the thing or the person, the movement that's being remembered. So Gandhi's legacy, I'm sure, has evolved over the last 60 plus years, and it'll evolve further into the future as new challenges arise. So I think legacies are not fixed. They're not historical monuments sort of crafted in stone. Yeah? They change, they adapt, they respond to changing circumstances. And I think we have to be very careful when we just think about history more generally, that history is always written at a certain point in time. So history itself is continually evolving. There's no sort of definitive story about what happened in the past. And legacy is part of that changing process for me.
Yes, yes, it is true. That legacy is a living thing. It flourishes, continues, it regenerates itself. Rajmohan Gandhi.
Ji.
Gandhiji visited Sin 7 times.
Sorry?
Gandhiji visited Sin 7 times.
Yes, yes, yes.
When he was in Sin 1934, he met with the press. At that time, separation of Sin from the Bombay, there was a movement.
Yes, of course.
When the editor of Sindh Observer asked him or sought the opinion of Gandhiji, he said, I repeat those words, quote unquote, he said, "Now you are taking me out of my depth." So what was that? He was influence of Congress. He was considering Sindh was very weak province, or Sindh was very ready to accept the docile.
Now, Gandhi was many things, but he was also an astute politician, as you know.
Yes.
And so when and he himself was a journalist.
Yes.
So when the editor of the Sindh Observer asks him on this, you might say, ticklish question at the time about the separation of Sindh from Bombay presidency, and Gandhi represents the Indian National Congress also. He was never a formal member, but he was, you might say, the leader of the Indian National Congress. And many of the strong supporters of the Indian National Congress were from Bombay, and they were the Gujaratis and the Marathi-speaking people of Bombay. And they were very attached to Sindh being part of Bombay presidency.
Yes.
So I think when Gandhi says, you are taking me out of my depths, what he's saying is, don't sink me in political waters. will you allow me to say something else?
Sure, you're welcome.
Because this was what Sarah was saying got me thinking on those lines about how some people in the West also responded to Gandhi because of non-violence and pacifism after the atom bomb and so on. But there was another aspect of Gandhi that I know many people in Britain responded to. You know, the 1919 April 13 Jallianwala Bagh massacre.
Yes.
After that, in December of 1919, there was a session of the Indian National Congress in Amritsar, very close to Jallianwala Bagh. And Gandhi at this time was not yet the unquestioned leader he had become. This was 1919, before the Khilafat and the Non-Cooperation Movement was launched. And at this Congress session in Amritsar, and Jinnah Sahib was then also in the Congress, he was present. Maulana Muhammad Ali, Maulana Shaukat Ali were also there. Jairam Das Daulatram was there from Sindh.
Yes.
Motilal Nehru was the president. And also present at this session was Annie Besant, who 2 years previously had been the president of the Indian National Congress, Annie Besant. So great session of the Indian National Congress, there was a resolution about the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. And it used very strong language that we oppose this and this should be condemned and the viceroy should be recalled and the governor should be dismissed. Then there was a paragraph at the end of the resolution which said, this house also deplores the violence at Indian hands. Now what had happened was that on 10th of April, 3 days before the massacre, 5 Englishmen had been killed in Amritsar. And an English woman, Miss Sherwood, had been assaulted. She was a school teacher. So the second part of this resolution also said, this house deplores the violence at the hands of Indian mobs. Something like that. Then there was a discussion about this, and speaker after speaker said, the first part of the resolution is very good. We would like to make it stronger, but we cannot agree with the second part. We should not equate the Jallianwala Bagh massacre with the killing of 5 or 6 people. Then one leader came and said, I don't know who has drafted this resolution. No son of an Indian mother could have drafted this resolution. And the implication was that this Annie Besant must have drafted it, because although she was Irish, she was white, so she must have drafted it. And they decided that they would reject the second part of the resolution and only pass the first part. Then Gandhi said, I want to speak. And he said, I've been thinking very deeply about this idea that no son of an Indian mother could have drafted this resolution. Then after deep thinking, says Gandhi, after deep thinking, I came to the conclusion that only the son of an Indian mother could have drafted it. And then he said, I have drafted it. And then according to observers at this meeting, Gandhi said at this meeting, if we don't have the courage to condemn the wrongs that we have committed, after independence, we will not have an independence led by good people, we will have, if we allow and welcome murders, we will have rule by murderers. And for the first time, and possibly the last time in the story of the Indian National Congress, they decided to have a fresh vote on the second half of the resolution, and that second half was reinstated. So when that happened, Gandhi received a letter from an Englishman called Pratt, P-R-A-T-T, who was a civil servant in Gujarat, and he and Gandhi had several fights on some issues of income tax and peasant land revenue and so on. Pratt wrote to Gandhi after that, he heard the news of this Amritsar Congress, and he said, after I read what you had said, I realized that I had many hard thoughts against you. I now feel bad that I had those hard thoughts against you, and I want to say sorry to you. So, I think she's absolutely right that somehow, for whatever reason, and I have a feeling that the sort of impression Gandhi made on English people is also one reason why he made an impact on Sindhis.
Yeah. Could I just add, though, certainly he made an impression, very favourable impression on some British people. There were obviously other British people who were particularly rude and dismissive of him.
Yes, of
political leaders, Churchill being the famous one. But as you will know, and probably most people in the audience will know, when he visited London for those roundtable conference discussions, he deliberately stayed in a part of London where he, let's say, put himself among the ordinary people who warmed to him tremendously. And when he went to the north of England, to Manchester,
Lancashire,
again, the same thing. And that was among people whose livelihoods, to an extent, his campaigns against foreign imported textiles directly impacted. And yet they, so, you know, they warmed to him. They saw him as being somebody who was fighting for the poor, the oppressed. And so the differences between them sort of melted away. So I think some British people certainly warmed him. Others retained right to the end a racist and dismissive attitude towards him. So
there's a question from you, Dr. Saram. Khadi movement was very, very near, very hard, very highly valued in whole philosophy and works of Gandhiji. But Khadi movement could not be rooted in sin. What was the reason? Poverty or something like that? What was the reason? Because it completely not a failed, but it was not taking roots in the sin.
Now that's a very tricky question for me to answer, because if I'm very frank, I hadn't thought of that before. So you're really putting me on the spot. It may be that the nature of Sindhi society in that sort of period, the interwar period, the rural-urban divide, perhaps people's incomes interfered. I really don't know the answer to that. From a sort of cultural perspective, one thing I have gathered is that for Sindhis, they needed a lot of cloth to make their clothes with. I mean, the amount of the cloth that went into making shalwar and other things was a big drain on their resources. I don't know how that impacts. It might have been relevant. But I think what we have to always sort of remember is the context of when these events happen, or how to contextualize, perhaps in this case, the fact that Khadi didn't really take off. And we're looking at the 20s, we're looking at the 30s. And that's a time in Sindh when, if not, we don't see the same perhaps breakdown of communal relations that we see in other parts maybe of northern India, but certainly the fabric is being strained. And we're moving from the time when Gandhi first came to Sindh during the First World War, but then he came again during the Khilafat non-cooperation movement, when Sindh was very active in that protest. He comes back again, 1931, but 34, when, as you said earlier, the campaign for a separate Sindh has gained a lot of ground. And it's moved from its early sort of expression, which was something that, in fact, Sindhi Hindus were pushing for commercial reasons, among other things, to a lobbying on the part of Sindhi Muslims, maybe as, you know, part of the bigger, sort of, as I said, pulling away of communities. So it may be that some of that background affects the way in which this movement fails to take off. But I certainly have to look more into this because you've given me a new idea to follow up.
Okay, thank you. Gandhiji, there is a triangle in Mahatma's life. Meera, Mahatma and Kasturbai. How you look at it?
Did everybody understand the question? Question is, he speaks of what he calls a triangle, Meera, Mahatma Gandhi and Kasturba Gandhi. As far as I remember, Madeleine Slade, which was her name,
exactly,
daughter of an English admiral, who was a great admirer of Beethoven. But she heard about Gandhi and wrote him a letter saying, I want to come and work with you, assist you. And she came in 1925, I think, for the first time. Gandhi asked her to learn how to spin before she came to India, charkha, and to read some things about India and maybe some other books he may have prescribed. I've forgotten what these were. And then Meera arrived. Oh, she was called Madeleine. And then Gandhi gave her the name Meera. And she was with him till 48 when Gandhi died. So that is what, 23 years. And there's no doubt that Meera was extremely devoted to and very fond of, she loved Gandhi.
Yes.
And Gandhi also loved her. There's no doubt about it. And he often said that he missed her if she was not around. And she also felt that, but there is no suggestion in any things that I have read, in any document or any other reliable work that I've read, of anything other than a very genuine, natural love, non-sexual love between Meera and Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. This is my understanding of it. And something else that not many are aware of is that this lady, Madeleine Slade, was politically a very astute woman. And sometimes in my mind, I have tried to divide some of Gandhi's close associates into those who are helping him in his quote-unquote constructive activities and those who are assisting him in his political battles. And I squarely place Meera Ben in the latter camp. Not only was she a very astute reader of political events, she was also, being the daughter of an English admiral, quite a feather in Gandhi's cap. And when he had important messages to send to the viceroy, he often sent Madeleine Slade to the viceroy. This, of course, strengthened Gandhi's position. And there are several letters that Gandhi wrote. Now, there was another interesting complication in this triangle, which was that when often Gandhi was in prison and he had little time to write letters, and Kasturba and Meera were in the same place in the Sabarmati ashram, Gandhi would write a letter to Meera in English, which was a letter for Kasturba and Meera both. And so Meera had to read out Gandhi's letter to Kasturba. We may think that this is odd, but we may also find it rather wonderful.
Yes.
And I have also found no evidence. I'm sure that there were many occasions when Kasturba may have felt, why are so many these women, Indian, Western women, who are able to speak English, who are able to talk about politics, they are often with my husband and they have these wonderful conversations and stimulating conversations. But such thoughts, if they occurred to Kasturba, were passing thoughts. And every evidence I found is that Kasturba had a very warm relationship with Meera and a warm regard for her.
Okay. You well said that there are a lot of persons who assisted Gandhi. There are a lot. But just as you are saying, two persons' names came into mind. One is Mahadev Desai, and second is from Hyderabad, Mr. Kriplani. How you comment on that they helped Gandhi to from a common person, from a Karamchand Gandhi to Mahatma Gandhi?
Yes, those are Mahadev Desai, who became Gandhi's very reliable, very efficient, extremely hardworking personal secretary, who was with Gandhi from 1917 to 1942 when he died in prison. Mahadev Desai died. For 25 years, this man, Mahadev Desai, lived Gandhi's life three times over each day. First, he would plan Gandhi's day. Aaj inhe kya kya karna, kitne baje kahan jana, ye, he plans Gandhi's day. Then he lives Gandhi's day with Gandhi. And late at night, he records Gandhi's day. So three times he lives Gandhi's life on that day. Incredible man. And Jeevatram Kriplani, as you say, from Hyderabad. By the way, once I heard, I was also quite close to him in his final years. I had the great privilege. He was in his late 80s and early 90s. And my wife, Usha, and I, we had the privilege of literally looking after him. Usha cooked some things for him. I was able also to do some malish for him. And sometimes I've heard him speak on the telephone, and he would also say, referring to other Sindhis who are not from Hyderabad, as Baharis. Yeah. Oh, Bahari hai na, wo, usne ye kaha. The real Sindhis to him were the Hyderabadis. Anyway, that was him. Now, he was a professor in Bihar, North Bihar, in Muzaffarpur. When Gandhi first arrived there for the famous Champaran Indigo producers Satyagraha. And Kriplani went to meet him at the station in Muzaffarpur. And naturally, he went to the first class compartment. He could not find him. And he was carrying a lalten to the train late at night. So finally, he went to some third class compartment and he found Gandhi there. Then Gandhi stayed in Kriplani's home. And Kriplani looked after him. As he says, he played a very large part in assisting Gandhiji and helping him, I think, to become what he became. But Kriplaniji also tells a very interesting conversation. This is when he met Gandhi in Shantiniketan at Tagore's place, where also Kriplani was. This was before they met in Muzaffarpur. And Gandhi asked him what he was doing. He said, I'm a professor. What are you a professor of? He said, I'm a professor of history. So Gandhi said, wonderful. Join me and we will make history. So.
Thank you. Dr. Sir, you worked on Sense, one famous book, Sufi Sense and State of Power. In that context, Mahatma and Freedom of Sin, how you associated those words at grassroots level?
Gosh. I think the first thing to say is that the word peer in a Sindhi context covers a wide range of, let's call them institutions, the religious institutions, from the great powerful peer families to much more humble spiritual leaders. So it's difficult to identify perhaps the Mahatma with some of those peer institutions because very different in practice. But I think that you are, I think I know what you're getting at, and I think that you are right, that there is, or there was, and still is, within Sindh, a strongly spiritual and syncretic set of traditions, which, on the sort of ground level, meant that you often did find people from different religions going to the same shrines, worshipping there. And so I think that that feeds into perhaps the question that you asked much earlier on about Gandhi's continued interest in Gandhi in Sindh. But I don't think that Gandhi, I find it very hard to identify him with sort of the bigger, more powerful peers in this part of the world, just because his life was much more down to earth, in touch with, let's call them, the common man and woman in practice. That's my feeling.
Okay, time is running behind, so we will open the house for the questions.
Sorry, can I interrupt? You've just been very kind and given us the book, yeah? And I would kindly request you if you could maybe just read us a short section from it to give people a flavor of what you've translated. But before you do that, I'm going to put you on the spot for a moment. Would you be able to give us some idea of maybe the challenges that faced you when you were translating this into Sindhi? Yeah? It was in English, you translated it into Sindhi. What challenges did you experience while you were doing this obviously very valuable job?
In fact, I realized three challenges. One, I was translating from English to Sindhi language, so I realized that there should be command on both languages when you are translating someone. But most important is Gandhi's works are very, very thickly contained. There are phrases, there are concepts. If you can't live with Gandhiji, you can't translate Gandhiji. You have to live. You have to realize what is non-violence. So that was difficult part, that I lived with Gandhiji, how he's how he acted in different situations. What is the non-violence? What is self-realization? How to convert insult into honor? So these were the challenges at a human level.
So finding the right words for that, was that tricky sometimes?
Sometimes it is very, very difficult. Two difficulties when you have to give the note sentences, what is the non-violence is, what is the self-realization is. Another part was to give a very brief biographical footnotes about the persons, about the places who were described in this book. So these were two parts I took very seriously, that people should understand and their fresh context for the young learners should be about the Gandhi.
Well, please just read us a short.
Time's running, which one part you like?
Well, you know the book much better than me, but I know that there are parts where we're looking, where you look, or talking about Gandhi and sweepers and that extract, maybe? If you can find
it. I love the whole book, but topic, Gandhi is a sweeper, is a sweeper, is very near to my heart. I'm sorry, it is in English, it is in Sindhi, so I hope you will.
Hum sab Sindhi sunna chahte hain.
Rajkot shahar je rehwasin ma, jekre kin Gandhi je mashhoor an patandar panja kakus saaf kaya, ain gand kichre ke thani ko kayo, to uhe rugi poriyat kamazatya hua. गांधी शहरन के वरी वरी चयो त काकूस में बनाली उठायो एक पेशाब लाए ए बे पायखाने लाए चो त इए करण सा काकूस जी सफाई करण ए पायखानो ढोए बाहर कडण उछलाण में वधिक आसानी थे थी गांधी जे खानदान जो राजकोट में वडो शान मान ए नामाचार होयो संदस डाडो राजकोट ए भरवारन रियासतन जो दीवान रही चुको हो उन करे इन जे कुटुंब के राजकोट शहर में शहर का बाहर परे परे ताई सबको सुणा दो कुदरत जो लकाव दिसो तो 70 सालन का पोए एक प्राइम मिनिस्टर जो बैरिस्टर पोटरो शहर जा काकूस ए घटर चकासे रहे हो गांधी उन्हीं दुखी घड़िए में एक कदम पोते न हटो पान मगरब के केतरी गालन ते तनकीद कंदो हो पर हमेशा चवंदो हो तमु गंदे पानी जे नेकाल ए शहरी सफाई जो इंतजाम मगरब का सिखियो आए इन अड़ो इंतजाम सिंध में भी चाहे पे देयर वन लास्ट क्वेश्चन what we could learn, what South Asia could learn from the Gandhi. Then we'll open the out further.
I think Junejo sahab, is sawal ka bhi jawab aap hi mujhse behtar denge. Abhi itne log puchna chahte hain. So many others were.
Please. Should I go first? My name is Kushbakht, and I don't have a question really, but I have a comment, and it's for Sir Zaffar. That can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. I don't have really a question, but I have a comment on the very first question you asked, Sir Zaffar. I really feel that it was not rightly phrased. I am a Sindhiani too, and it was like not representing all the publishers and all the viewpoints of all the Sindhis. So I would just comment that, yeah, it just came as a little weird to, I guess, so many others would support too. So that's a comment on your very first question.
Yeah, my question is to Mr. Rajmohan Gandhi. Do you think that legacy of Gandhi and ways and methods adopted by him against the dominance are in any way relevant with the current scenario and situation on both sides of, whether in Pakistan or in India?
Well, okay. So let us see which of the following things are relevant or irrelevant. One, Gandhi said that elites and people should consider the needs of the poor first. Gandhi said Muslims, Hindus, Sikhs should live together, if not in harmony, at least in peaceful coexistence. Gandhi said that if we are to struggle against oppression, you must struggle absolutely fearlessly. You must be willing to be killed, but you must not be willing to kill. These are three of his principles. I would like people to decide whether they are relevant or not relevant.
Please,
Ms. Ansari, this is a question for you. I think you've not understood the legacy of Sufism in Sindh, in Punjab, in the whole subcontinent. Because I see Gandhi very much as a follower of that non-violent tradition. And you have reduced it to the institution of Peeds and Peeri, which is not the question that Mr. Zaffar asked you. Because I think non-violence was the basic, was what Sufis all over the subcontinent, and they were activists in their own way, they were political activists, at least in Sindh and in the Punjab. So how come you've reduced it to the institution of the feudal peers?
Can I just respond? When Junejo Sahab asked me, he used the word peerdom. Yeah? So I was answering in relation to peerdom. I totally agree with the point you've made. But I, being a sort of fairly empirical historian, heard the word peerdom and considered the institution of the peer. Now, I think, as you've just pointed out, there can be a world of difference between the institution of the peer and the philosophy of the Sufi, which, as you rightly say, was very often infused with non-violence. Not always, but very often. So I beg just to explain why I chose to answer it in that way. But I take your point. Thank you.
I'm a great admirer of the Mahatma, and I have become a great admirer of you since I have had the privilege of listening to you, sir. But at the same time, I would like to quote a verse from Iqbal. Khugare humse thoda sa gila bhi sun le. Meri arz ye hai, that as far as I have read or heard, Gandhi ji was the first to introduce the religious factor in the political scenario in the subcontinent. The examples are the Khilafat movement, he evoked the religious precepts, and also religious precepts, and also the you know quoting from the scriptures. And I think perhaps this was a very great tragedy in the subcontinent's political scene. May I invite your comment, sir?
Yeah, thank you. That's a very important question. I would say that whatever you or anyone else finds wrong or erroneous or weak or flawed in Gandhi's legacy, you should feel free to reject it. If you find some things that are positive, useful, constructive, we should feel free to adopt them. Of course, we can all write, we can all give grades to Gandhi if we want. Each one of us is free to give our own verdicts on his life and his work and his message, when we should feel completely free. I will take no offense as far as I'm concerned. But just on a technical point, I don't agree that Gandhi was the first to introduce religion into politics. When it was decided that there should be separate electorates and the Muslim League asked for separate electorates, that also was introduction of religion into politics, understandably so. And this was 1906, 1909. And Congress party resolutions also were filled with religious phrases. Annie Besant, who was a very leading figure of the Congress party, Lokmanya Tilak, had made a big issue of the Ganesh festival in Maharashtra. So both from the Hindu side and from the Muslim side and from the Sikh side, religion was heavily introduced into Indian politics. Yes, Gandhiji did say, when the Khilafat thing happened, when the bulk of the Muslims of India seemed to be extremely unhappy with the fact that Makkah, Medina, Najaf, Karbala, Jerusalem will all be under some kind of European control after Turkey was defeated, and Muslim India became very unhappy about this, and Jallianwala Bagh also happened, then Gandhi, who also was a very shrewd politician, he said two or three times in the year 1920, ki hame 100 saal mein pehla mauka aa raha hai jab Musalman aur Hindu saath khade hokar ke azadi ke liye ladenge. Now, and by the way, at that time, Jinnah Sahib also supported the fight on behalf of Turkey and on behalf of Khilafat. I'm not saying that Gandhi was right or Gandhi was wrong, but as a student of history, these are some things that I have also discovered. But let us feel free to reject whatever we feel was weak or flawed in Gandhi and accept whatever we feel was sound in him.
Noora Manjanji. Noora Manjanji from a far-off village of Tharparkar, adjacent to the Indian border. I would like to have sharing of something, just comment and one question. My father had shared with me one thing, and because he had got his primary education at a small village, Dholka, near Ahmedabad, so he said they had been at Gandhi's ashram on every weekend and they met all the children of that school, irrespective of caste, creed and religion, with the Gandhi, and he talked him about sovereignty of this land and about the education, and then all of the children were treated with grams on leaves of banana, and we were delighted to see there all of the great Indian leaders, and he named a person Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel. Another comment that people of Thar, in that context,
comment a direct question, please.
Yes, I'm coming on that. So, any person who had been engaged in a work of reform, people had called him or her as a Gandhi, him as a Gandhi. So, my question is that, this is age of information technology, we can say cyber age. Gandhi has taught two things. One is policy of philosophy of non-violence, and the other of consumption of country's goods products. So, sir, how can you explain these two things? Non-violence is very justifiable, and the other thing, please comment on it. Thank you.
I wish Gandhi were here to justify his recommendations. Mera naam to Rajmohan Gandhi hai.
So this will be the last question and then we will close the session, right? Thank you.
Rajmohan ji. Mic ki kholi, please.
Hello.
Please.
Yeah, that's it.
Yes.
Rajmohan ji, I must thank you very much for visiting Pakistan and Karachi in particular. The journey that you have taken, traveling from Bombay to Karachi, let us pray that it creates a bridge between the two countries with your talks. I was present at the inaugural function and I heard you, your philosophical thoughts on creating a South Asia house where all the relatives live with normal feelings of love and dislike, but the relation continues. My question is related to Mahatma's legacy on two points, if you could just give your comment. One is, what are the surviving and existing impact on a gender discrimination in South Asia in particular and the world in general? Gender discrimination. And the second point is non-violence as a norm of political and social life which exists even today. How do you foresee things happening? Lastly, I feel that I must say that I have a feeling that Mahatma is somewhere here listening to all the talks that you have had, we have had with you and the discussion that we had together. Mahatma Gandhi is unified, symbolic angel for the whole world today.
Sir, I think your very important questions to me are worth reflecting upon by all of us. I don't feel that I should be required to really answer them more than anybody else. What you say is true, that if Mahatma Gandhi is hovering about here and listening to everything I say, to mujhe dar hai ki baad mein mujhe wo daantenge.
There is a last question from Fakhruddin J. Ibrahim Saab, please.
Sir, I am a committed pacifist, but I find myself in great difficulties when I face Talibans. They kill first and then ask questions. What do I do?
I don't think even Gandhi would ask anyone to be a pacifist before the Taliban or any other person who violently attacks innocent people.
Thank you very much. Session is closed. Rajmohan Gandhi and Dr. Saraf Ansari, thank you very much. Book is available. Thank you. Thank you very much.